Okay, welcome viewers. We got another edition of Field of Dreams, and my name is Steve David, and I'm your host. And today we talk women football, and I've got two ex, and not too far back ex, but two recently ex footballers that's going to help me go through this process together with Narada Wilson. And let me take time to introduce Isla Brown. Isla, you were the former captain.
Yes.
And you also was an under-20 coach,
yes,
right?
Yes, the 2013, 2014, U20.
Okay, what else can you tell us about Isla?
Well, besides ex-player and ex-coach, that's about it. Just passionate about women's football.
All right, and you're still involved in...
Yes, I try to be.
Okay, good. And next to Isla is Janelle James. And Janelle, what does WOLF mean?
Women's League Football.
Women's League Football. And you're the rep?
The media officer.
Media for that?
Yes.
And also you're involved with FIFA and other things?
Yes.
Tell the viewers a little bit about what Isla.
Well, I work in the FIFA Development Office for the Northwest Caribbean as the Assistant Development Officer. Women's football is pretty much what I do. WOLF, developmental, pro league, whatever it is, I'm in it.
You're involved,
yeah.
Right. Welcome, guys. We are glad to have you. And to my left is my comrade, Narada Wilson. Narada, welcome back, buddy.
Always a pleasure to be here.
All right.
Today we'll take the angle down to the women's side of the game.
Let's see what happens with this woman. Okay, so let's get to work, right?
Yeah.
State of women football, what do you guys think? Are we going in the right direction? Are we going to cross? Or are we going up? Or are we going down? Or sideways? What are we doing? What do you think?
I think we're going up. My honest opinion about it is we've done tremendously for the last 2 years. We have had two of our teams almost qualify for World Cups, going through the qualifying stages, which hasn't happened to us ever before in terms of our program. And so in that regard, I think that is tremendous for a program that probably started way before me, you know, but particularly for the players, the senior team players who just reaching there, just missing it, you know, by that last goal. That team in particular, you know, was the team that all of us in the program, Janelle, myself, Jamal, Shabazz, a couple others, started from youngsters. They were like 13 or 14. And they were like the team we decided the program must take a whole dimension from in terms of progress. And we see that this team is the team pretty much, these are the players that pretty much almost qualify for the World Cup. I think for me, the part I'm not too happy about is a certain amount of regression in terms of us not putting things in place to maintain what was done with that group for the rest of the program. You know, we've had spurts. We've had a good U17 team that we had the World Cup here. That's a nice group of players also. But since then, we've been kind of tottering. You know, hopefully, you know, we have a new administration. Hopefully, you know, they get the women's program back on track. And hopefully, we have a lot more success where that is concerned.
You guys are the pioneers. And don't you feel like, though, is a... I almost say Isla, but it's Isla. Don't you feel, though, like you guys have paved a nice way and the conditions now are so much better than when you played? Don't you wish like you were in this time? What do you think about that, Jenna? You want to answer that question?
I mean, for me, back in the day, I would have loved to have the opportunity that these ladies have, but... me of now, and understanding the responsibility of creating opportunities and creating a pathway for the development and the growth of the sport. I have no problems with where I'm at now. You know, as Isla said, the women's game is on the up and up. However, it is important, and moving away from the field to the administration, it is important for the administrators to understand the direction, have a direction themselves so that the players can get to the necessary level, harness the program, because I think the program, women's football, is all over the place right now. So I think the fraternity or sorority, being technically correct, needs to really come together and develop ideas, develop a philosophy of where we really want women's football to go. You know, because after this group of players here, as Isla said, there was a lot of time and investment in this particular group of players. After this, then what? And we must know, and we must know quickly, because then we'll be starting at ground zero.
Yeah. Right.
You know, so.
Different levels. You think we have the levels, Loretta?
Just going back from the generation that you all played with and looking at the generation now, I think it was a program that probably had about 10 years. I don't know if back then they probably sat down and said, this is the goal for the next 10 years. But these were girls that came out of a pretty decent high school league. Most of them got scholarships to the U.S., so you saw a pathway. After scholarships from the U.S., they came back and they played at a national program that had more games than generations before. What is happening today is that we're seeing maybe the high school league is still okay, but we're not seeing that pathway. We're seeing we have the Wolf League, which probably should have been, in case you don't get a scholarship abroad, you still have some sort of structured football to play. And then we should probably even look at the WPL, which was introduced, as being even for the girls that don't have professional contracts to still have an opportunity to still play football. Because there are two or three leagues that we could actually use systematically for these girls. And also, when they reach on the national team, it's fine. The girls are the present crop. They've been together for 10 to 15 years. Mm-hmm. But what we're seeing is we're seeing very few players from the under 17 or under 20 making a breakout into these teams. And what happens with this crop of players, if 2016 doesn't go the way we want it to go, we have approximately 2 years that isn't really, there isn't much high-level football, competitive football. And what do we do in that period in time? I think, just as Janelle said, the stakeholders need to really sit down and say, listen, this project started 10 years ago. We got it right. Let's continue. Nobody needs to bring too many new ideas and dismantle and recreate or whatever the case is. It's just to sit down on paper and say, it worked. Let's continue with a group of under 15 maybe and see how we could fix the pathway.
I mean, sorry.
Okay, go ahead.
No, just to add to that, you know, in terms of the pathway, I think there has been that pathway has been there. I think the problem that I see is that we have, as a program, we have been able to qualify at each level, good, for CONCACAF, which is, I think, is huge. I mean, you know, we are the top team, one of the top teams in the Caribbean, if not, dare I say, the top team in the Caribbean in women's football. Mm-hmm. And we, our youth teams, you know, follow suit in terms of qualifying for CONCACAF, which enhances the progression into the senior team level. But I just think that besides, that should not now be the goal anymore.
Correct.
We should, because we have done it. We go to CONCACAF all the time. You know, that is not the hurdle in my head anymore. The hurdle for me in, you know, it's getting to the World Cups, and getting to the World Cup at U17, U20. So by the time those players get to U20 to filter into the senior team, we'll have more experienced players, more players ready for that transition, you know, and it helps to maintain the senior team level, you know, to get over that hurdle and get over that hurdle to the World Cup on a more regular basis instead of just this year, next 6 years, maybe, or more, which is not, you know, which is not what I think, you know, it should be seen that I think we had the idea and everything in place for it to move the way it needs to move. and for the results you need to get in terms of getting to the World Cup? Because at the end of the day, that is the pinnacle, getting to the World Cup.
So what's the hiccup, Janelle? What is causing this hiccup?
Several things.
Tell the viewers what you think the hiccups are.
From support from the governing body to, again, proper strategic planning to coaches and understanding this is where the players are, this is where I want the players to be, and how to work with the resources that you have, yes, and the administrators. And if all of these different factors are not working together, we have problems.
Right.
We have serious problems because the administrator want to be the coach. And the coach want to be a Jose Mourinho. He don't want to listen to anybody else,
right,
what anybody else have to say.
Right.
And then the players are observing, and the players are very smart.
Right.
They understand what's going on at that level. So if you have that pulling and tugging at that level, plus no support from the TTFE, where are we going? Where are we going? You have SSFL is a body by itself. They're doing their own thing. Well, let me take it further. You have primary school. They are a body by themselves. You have SSFL, which is a body by itself.
Right.
You have Wolf, which is a body by itself. And then you have the national programs, which pretty much is a body by itself. Where's the continuity there? What happens for a young lady who excels at primary school league, at the primary school league, to get into a national program? What happens? What is the development plan? Is there one? There's none. And that's the problem.
I was about to say, they hold hands from elementary school to SSL, FL, right? But then there was no hand-holding beyond that. Because the Wolf, and explain, what is the Wolf? Tell the viewers what the Wolf, the Wolves
I mean,
are.
The Wolf is essentially the National League for Women's Football. So it comprises of clubs throughout Trinidad and Tobago, competing over a 3 to 4 month period. Usually we start in May and end of July to August.
And that just started last year? For the first year was last year?
No.
Wolf was before that?
Wolf has been around.
Oh, okay.
Initially it was under the Women's Football Association.
Oh, I talk about the Pro League, right?
Yeah, you're talking about the WBL.
So the transfer from the secondary school league, the Wolf should have been an easy...
Well, the thing about it though, and in recent time, I think either the last 2 or 3 years, we've had these secondary schools, some secondary schools, participating in Wolf, using it as a pre-season to the SSFL. And these are the teams that are actually successful at the secondary schools level because they're competing with older and more experienced players. So you find when they go into secondary school league, they kind of run over the competition. So yes, we have that the league providing the opportunity where these girls can play, but there needs to be a serious attempt and effort by the stakeholders and those of us involved in women's football to really create a proper pathway of development. Trinidad and Tobago don't like development. They like when we're on top.
Right.
When you reach there, that's when we pay attention. But there needs to be development. And once we have the development and everybody working together and understanding their role, then there won't be any problems. There's success. We'll be happy.
Who has the answer? You? Or you have the answer?
We'll be
happy. What's your answer, Narada?
In a situation like this, I believe one of the unfortunate things with the women football is that because the SSFL and the Wolf, for want of a better word, may not be holding hands, you find you have secondary schools with one or two players that may be on the national program that really stand way out in the secondary schools league, or they're just not surrounded by enough girls that are, you know, equal or better than them. Now, somebody could say, well, in the male side, you have schools like, you know, maybe a St. Anthony's or wherever, who have two or three national players, but the guys around them are good enough, you know, to at least give them some sort of competition. With the women, you may find, and I used this name on a program once, Renee Ward, who I've dealt with at a younger age. She goes to Bishop's. Now, I don't know if Bishops is surrounded by at least two or three girls at her level, so mm-hmm. she may be the only one. So for a couple of weeks, she plays at a somewhat lower level. Then she plays with her club at a somewhat better level, and then the national team at an even higher level because they have her at like the under 17 and the under 20. So we need to find, and I was glad to hear that some of the secondary schools are even using the Wolf, because I think it's one of the best options, even if we just have about five of the top secondary schools, or who come in maybe the top four in the secondary schools, to somehow join the Wolf so they can constantly play at a good enough level, or make the transition from primary school to have girls actually look at wanting to go a particular secondary school because of the football program that the school offers. Because if not, you're just going to have everybody just separating, coming together, separating again, and you're just going to be cutting down the numbers. By the time it reaches the national program, you no longer have 200 girls interested in playing football. It boils down to two or three because the pathway is so hard. There's so many different branches that by the time they come to the end, you've probably lost about 75% of the players playing.
I think for me, there's one common denominator. And I think if everybody look at it like that, but I have to learn that not everybody looks at things the way I do. I always do that, and then I get myself into problems, you know. But I think it should always be about the player. And if everybody think in that respect, this is a good player, like the same player. She's a good player. How beneficial is this to her? You know, how would it benefit her? And we can go down, there's a long list of benefits. As, you know, a young lady in the game of football, the opportunities now, with her getting higher and higher, you know, in the game. And I mean, and for us in the women's football, it's not just about the game, it's holistic, you know. When they come out of, to me, from what I've seen, the players that come into the program, when they leave, they are nothing like what they came in. They are very, the senior team, I've been around them from, they were 13, and some of them, I just like, I'm in awe. I like, but they are such great adults now, you know, that I didn't even think some of them, you know, I was like, wow. You know, generally, I would be like, wow. You know, the decisions, the conversations you're having with them now is unbelievable.
So they've grown a little bit.
They've grown and into very responsible, you know, adults. It is unbelievable. So I always think about if you're an individual and, you know, you have players and or young ladies interested in, what is in the best interest of this player? How can we help them fulfill, you know, if their goal is to play at the highest level? How could we, as a school or as a club, help in helping them attain, because reaching the national team level has rewards. I mean, you know, and for me, if some of the schools or the club don't, they're not sure about, you know, because I can't understand why they're not sure about the gains by now, but it's not a problem. We could get things and list it, you know, so that they can see, well, like, the benefits for the people that are interested, the girls that are interested in playing at the highest level. So I would do everything in my power to ensure or to help this player or these players, you know, attain, you know, the highest level. So I think the problem comes down to, you know, some people take the player out of the whole scenario and put whatever else, and it gets blurred.
So let's take a break and think about this, and when we come back, we will see what we can do to make that happen. We'll be right back.
Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited offers solutions to your immediate and future potential problem areas by providing you with a qualified team of safety consultants. Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited, building a reputation on quality and value since 1999. Located 23 Todd Street, San Fernando, Trinidad. Phone 868-657-1534 or 868-788-6955. WorldwideSafety@yahoo.com.
welcome back, viewers. You're watching Field of Dreams, and this is Axe Television Network. Before the break, Izella was talking about the formation and or the level of the transformation level, and personally, I think coaching has a lot to do with it, because there's not the level of coaching that we need, which we need in the lower ranks. What do you think?
That partially could be it. That in some instances, that is it. I think also administration to a certain level, you know, it kind of works hand in hand. You know, one without the other. In terms of, let's take a small example of a scenario with the secondary school league one time with women's football. Women's football is young, you know. So there are things that needs to be done that is not similar to the boys, you know, or the men. So when we started, there were schools who didn't have teams and players from who can play from another school could join the next, which I think was tremendous. I think that is good. I mean, yes, you want to have a team, but what if they don't have a team? What happens to that player who can't play? But they were allowed to go to a team and play, and I think that was great. Then they stopped it. And then I was like, that makes no sense. You know, for what, where's the dialogue as to, all right, if you stop it, what's the other option for those players who don't have teams, you know? Because you don't know the scenario of the school that they can't have a team. But what happens to those players who can't play? So that's regression for those players, you know?
Janelle, I attack her fraternity coaching. You realize that she transferred off the your
to the administration.
So let me hear you defend yourself there on that
well,
one.
Well, you know, for me, it goes even much deeper than just the coaching and administration and all that. But it really is about how Trinidad and Tobago looks at sport. Trinidad and Tobago do not appreciate the, and we use this word flippantly, for lack of a better word, professionalism of sport. In other countries, a coach does not, he has to go through years of different levels to be certified. We have people in primary schools where the fundamentals need to be given to these children at their youngest age, when they could absorb everything, and they absorb everything easily. Now, if somebody who's not certified nor understand the fundamentals of the game is coaching these children, right away we have they're learning bad habits. So if that is happening from the inset, then what are we really doing? And it's hard as they get older to undo the problems. It's very hard. So we overall, and in both in the boys and girls, we lose potential players. We lose a lot of players with good ability because of poor foundation. And we need to really take a look, the sporting fraternity, at how we look at sport, stakeholders, and understand the importance of sport. Here in Trinidad, there's no proper certification licenses for coaches. There's no proper certification. So what, really, when we talk in football, the coach not certified, it don't have proper certificate or licenses for the coach. So what are we doing, really? Mm-hmm. What are we doing? We're wasting time, and it hurts the players. Because at the end of the day, as in our cases, when we get to CONCACAF level and we lose, we go right back down to ground zero. Because now we have to motivate players and say, okay, don't study it, we'll do better. But the same thing keeps happening. And there's no opportunity for advancement for the coaches. In women's football in Trinidad and Tobago, I think the most learned person is Jamal Chavez. But since after him, there's not been an opportunity for coaches to really learn. I mean, we had Evan Pellerud. We had Evan Pellerud for 4 years. But I don't think he was utilized in a good manner to help younger coaches really understand the women's game and developing and measuring. Jamal did a good job with those around him, like Isla and myself, in understanding and looking at the games differently, because we took the losses as learning periods and understanding before. Because before, when we were in tournaments, we would come back and we would stop. And he's like, that can't happen. That's what killing us. That's what killing us. So we now, lesson learned, we come back, and whether the federation support or not, we have training. Yeah. And that is the era that Mili and Tasha St. Louis, that's the era that they came up under.
Yeah.
Whether the federation's supporting us or not, we continue training.
That's the way.
We continue training. Monies came out from our own pockets. But this, the rewards are here. We were not wrong. That's what it took.
Yeah.
That's what it took. It was very rewarding for me to see December 2nd and see a stadium packed with people to see these players.
Wishing you were there too, right?
Never about me. No. Always about them.
It's about the game.
Always about them.
You
feeling
game.
Really good.
Yeah. You don't feel like, oh, Lord.
No. Appreciating that, you know, it took us 10 years, but we were on the right track.
Yeah. That's good.
Yeah.
No matter what you think. You had the answers for
that? I think there's always an answer once you're willing to speak. I think at the primary school level, for example, we have the issue with the secondary, with the school teachers who may not necessarily be certified. But I also believe that Federation could certify them just at a lower level because it's introductory. The hard thing about primary school is that parents are they're not very receptive of having an outsider come into the school to teach the kids something. You have a certain respect for teachers because you know they're employed there for a while or whatever the case is. But a case in Brazil is that what they do is they take two or three teachers per school who have an interest in a sport or football or whatever the case is, and just teach them some basic psychology, some introduction to the game. So that works at that level. When you're going to the secondary school, the angle that the women take is that now women are now developing. So there are research that show women stop playing football or swimming because they're upper body starts to go a particular way or lower body. You know, different. It's a different structure opposed to men. Men want to get bulkier, women don't.
Right.
So it's a different personality you're dealing with. But then is where now you take coaches, who I believe in Trinidad, we do this top-to-bottom approach where we put the best coaches at the later stage. When coaches should be wanting to take pride in working with the youth, but it's so much about them that they want to be at the highest level so they could say, yes, I did it. Why not be at the lowest level where you could say, I did it as well? Yes, the players may move on and somebody else may get credit, but you have to be selfless about it.
Yeah.
So you work at the 11 to 16 category, you put the best coaches because now they're learning the fundamentals and tactics and whatever the case is, and you put them there. So by the time these girls go into Wolf, WPL, or at the clubs or university even, because that's our pathway, they should have everything down packed. So I don't even think much of the issues is really just not everyone wanting to sit around the table and respect each other's opinion. Everyone wants to hold theirs. So for example, the coaches say we are the solution, the administrators say we are the solution, technical staff says the same thing, and nobody wants to sit down because I think we have a blueprint that is proven. You know, you've used the name Mr. Shabazz, whoever were the people around at that period in time, take that entire blueprint, put it down, say it's worked. Let's see how we could put it now at this stage and do it over again. But this time we get it right and we continue every single year just doing that and just adding on top of it.
And that brings it back to the same thing. It should always be about the players. So, because if you're going to a program thinking what's best for the players, even if you're one of the top coaches and they say, well, we want you to work at U17, of course, it should not even be a second thought. Because then if you understand the way things operate and how progression goes, if you have one of your top coaches at the bottom for your development, what would you gain as they go up? They're properly developed, you know. I mean, volumes as they go up. So, I mean, again, it comes back. You know, what's best for the players? What's best for the program and the players in the program in order for us to get success, you know?
Okay. Let's talk about Wolf a little bit. Wolf is the women's league, like the Super League. Like, what the men's Super League is, or just like a normal league, right?
Exactly.
So, and that is run in zones, or it's a national league?
It's a national league, and in recent times, what we've done is to put the teams in zones because so that they don't have to worry about the cost to travel from north to south, Tobago, etc. We try to minimize the cost because these clubs are small and they aren't sponsored. So we'd find that you have your south group, you have your north group, and we're still trying to encourage Tobago to have their own group so that they don't have to have that kind of cost to travel to and from Trinidad.
Okay, and I'm sure Point Fortin is the best team in the country as usual, right?
I don't want to hurt your feelings, but okay.
All right. Where does Point Fortin sit? I just wanted from a personal
Point Fortin actually is one of the better teams. They've come up from the lower division to be one of the top three teams, I believe, in the Premier Division,
right,
which is the higher level competition.
Okay.
So Point actually is one of the top three teams.
One of the good teams.
Yeah, they are. Lots of young talent down there.
So Wolf has different levels, Premier and
First Division.
And First Division.
Yeah, and because we don't want to for teams to take advantage and then the younger players get disillusioned and not interested because...
So structurally, we have a great women's program.
Mm-hmm. Sort of.
We
have the potential.
Potential.
Execution is our problem. Mm-hmm. Execution is our problem. Executing the league properly, year in, year out, is a problem. Getting sponsors for the league and the financial assistance that is necessary to run a proper league has always been a major hurdle that we have to face. And what we find is that every year more and more clubs want to play. More and more teams seem to be interested. You know, we've had as many as 20 clubs, 20 women's clubs. When you tell that to other people around the world, they wouldn't believe that 20 women's teams, actually, you could find that in Trinidad and Tobago. People struggle to do that. And there's 11v11, and each team average about 18. So do the maths there. We have the interest. Mm-hmm. But again, we have to execute properly. We have to, as administrators, we really have to take it serious. We really have to take it serious.
Yeah, I think, I didn't know it was that big, and I didn't know, I mean, I think we should put a little bit more effort into the women's league as a country.
Yeah.
I think you guys getting recognition now based on what I've seen with our national team, but everybody concentrated on the national team.
Yeah.
As soon as we start winning something, everybody's in it, and then we start losing and everybody backpedals again. My favorite team in the world that I would turn off the TV to watch, you know who, or turn on the TV to watch, is the U.S. Women's National Team. That is my favorite team in the world. I think they're the best team. That's what I want to watch. Because I would turn off Brazil, England, or Brazil, Germany, man, to watch the women's national team. I like the women's national team. I think they're good.
Yep.
So women's football is just as big as men, and we should treat it that way. And I don't think we are.
I think now, I mean, for us who've been in it for a while, we understand, and it's been difficult. But I think... I keep saying that December 2nd was a special day for women's football. It really is the beginning. It is the beginning because people really now understand that we actually have players who could play. So now anytime people hear women's football, they have a connection. They have December 2nd in their mind. So I think we now will, doors are slightly opened and being a little more willing to hear us out and hear our needs and a little more open to support. Before, they didn't know. All they could say, as you say, was the U.S. Women's National Team because that's what is there for them.
Right.
And we didn't have that.
No.
But December 2nd is really the starting point at the beginning for really building on that moment,
Isla,
in
you
my opinion.
You think you would ever beat my team?
The U.S.?
National Women's Team.
That's your team?
Yeah.
Okay. Why not?
You think so? Do you ever get to that point?
I think we can.
Okay.
I think we can. You know, once things are put in place and, you know, there's, you have to have a winning mentality, you know, in totality. I mean, the players might want to win, but nothing is in place for them to be able to do such.
Correct. And I always hear that, though. We just have to put it in place, but nobody's saying, what do we have to put in place?
Everything that is necessary. What is necessary for you to be able to compete at the top level? Proper preparation is the key to me success in everything. Good. We know we have a national team, a senior team. You're just using the senior team as an example. 3.5 years to prepare before qualifiers, or 3 years per se. What is necessary? 3 years of preparation, strength and conditioning, games, good. A coach that you've, the federation or the association feels or could carry the team for the next 4 years to that point. Good. Sometimes it means bringing a coach from outside with the experience, you know. Sometimes that is necessary. But we know, and this is not something that because I always baffle. I like, don't they? But they know that this is what is necessary. Why isn't it not put in place? Why aren't we having, you know, friendlies, X amount of friendlies, you know, for the year? And then people say, well, you know, we do too badly, you know, and you know, the team playing good, we might beat the States or we might beat Canada. I am not one of those optimists, because I can't see a team playing two friendly internationals against, you know, Jamaica and, you know, maybe one game against Costa Rica. Yeah. Beat a U.S. team who has played 15 to 20 friendlies against the top teams in the world for the whole year. I mean, to me, that is unrealistic.
Right. That's why I said that.
To me, that is unrealistic.
My thing is, I am the same mantra Ms. Brown is putting forward. It's about the players, right? But I believe also, with that being said, the players need to look out for themselves or have people look out for them. Now, this is probably the agent side of me coming in. I tell people, and another thing I always try to say is that I'm pushing this year to make it known. A lot of statistics are there, but people don't know. How many women in secondary school at the moment want to go to university? Quite a lot. How many know that playing football, you could potentially go on a full scholarship to the same university that you probably want to go? Not many of them. We need to show that maybe from this national team that we had, that 22,000 people paid money to go and watch, how many of them went through the secondary, then went on full scholarships, and are where they are right now. Another thing we have to look at is that a lot of these players are not, and it may sound bad, are not playing professional football for nearly 10 months, 8 to 10 months out of the year. Mm-hmm. We look at the men's side of the game. Even if you look at a big country like Brazil, when they call in players, they could afford to call in players 2 days before, just put them in a nice hotel, give them nice food. The preparations could somewhat be even minimal because these players are technically playing constantly, day in, day out, football. And I'll use something small before we go to a break, is that we had 4 players work with the ministry recently. Mm-hmm. Good, you know, good motivation, good incentive. But I would have probably liked to see those 4 players be paid that same salary, take the ministry, pay it for them to play to a club, tell the club, you are basically sending these players to play there, and I will pay their salary, because I'm sure it could have, in certain countries, it could have worked for them to, you know, clubs will give housing, they'll pay for the flight, pay the salary for living expense, and let them play football for the couple months instead of working. That's my thing.
How do you know you're going to break from the We'll be right back after the short break.
Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited offers solutions to your immediate and future potential problem areas by providing you with a qualified team of safety consultants. Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited. building a reputation on quality and value since 1999. Located 23 Todd Street, San Fernando, Trinidad. Phone 868-657-1534 or 868-788-6955. worldwidesafety@yahoo.com.
Welcome back, viewers. You still tuned in to Field of Dreams on Axe Television Network. Okay, before the break, we were talking about you can't beat my U.S. national team, right? And we talk all of this stuff. And trust me, I'd love to see Trinidad beat the U.S. national team, but I think, and you guys hold me ransom on this, I'll tell you what the U.S. have that we don't. I think there is a difference between determination and discipline. Or let's say desire. Desire and discipline. Desire, discipline takes you to the destination, not desire. It's still so different. Anybody can want it. Oh yeah, I want to do this, I want to do that. But to get up and go do it, and we always, yeah, we want to do this, and if we can get this, and then they get it, and they don't have the discipline. And I think that's what. We don't treat this as the U.S. look at it as war, or this is for, my life depends on it. I don't think we have that grit in our society.
I beg to differ.
Okay, I'm glad you did.
I beg to differ.
Okay, tell me
why. When we were playing, it didn't have no players. I say this, you don't have players who had the discipline, desire, determination, you know, and want it. I mean, really want it.
Like?
But the support system wasn't there. And I know for a fact, because when I have a really good friend and she played in the U.S. the same time that I started to play, she didn't make the tournament at the time. As we would have met in Haiti, she got her leg broken and she wasn't able to play. So I played in that tournament, right? And that U.S. team struggled, just like us, just at the time. The women's football wasn't anything in the U.S. You know, they didn't used to get this. They weren't recognized. We were pretty much in the same scenario, you know? They won, blah, 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 good. And they got back. We came third in that tournament. We were one of the first three teams in the CONCACAF. First Canada, the US, Canada, and Trinidad and Tobago. And we came back from that tournament and nothing happened. Mexico never beat us. Costa Rica never beat us. And nobody else ever beat us except for the US and Canada. And we came back from that tournament being third. By the time we went to the next tournament, because we came home and nothing happened. Mexico was beating us. Costa Rica was beating us. We struggled worse against the U.S. and Canada. But the U.S. team went back, and their support grew. Their association started to put money. And, with money, improvement, and support system, which we didn't have. So those two teams started to get better, and then we just went down and stayed where we were. You know, even Mexico and Costa Rica, their federation started to spend money and they started to now go up, and we just kind of like bubble around right here. So, you know, while it's we can say that, you know, but I know for a fact that I haven't seen, even my generation and even, you know, generations after that, they just get really despondent. And I've seen it. I've seen players not play. You know, they're like, it's too much and we're not going anywhere. And it's the same thing over and over. And they quit.
Well, Janelle, don't you feel like that? Because again, my point is, discipline If I want this for me, whatever the Federation do, that's their problem. I'm going to work my butt off and get to the point. I think there's some of the girls now who have that discipline. But I don't think...
They do. But if you're in it, and you're in it for a long time, and it's the same scenario every time, you get to that point. You get to that point where, you know, I had enough.
You know, people say, oh yeah, I want to, like, for this year, my New Year resolution is to lose weight, and they really want to lose weight. But when time to come to do the thing, they don't have the discipline. Yes?
Yes, but this is not okay. the same scenario.
So tell me what you think. Give
different.
Me your
voice. Again, echo the sentiments of Isla. Mm-hmm. The players do want to succeed after one stint. And usually, let's start from youth level. They usually start training two years in. So after they've gone through that preparation, unknowing to them, because they are the youngest, so they don't really understand it yet. So they're excited, they're preparing, the groups start getting smaller and smaller, getting into competition. We do well at Caribbean level. They feel on a high, they've succeeded, we usually win. We come back to the drawing board, start preparing, training for CONCACAF. Unknowing to them, CONCACAF is where you meet the monsters. This is the real deal, the Mexico, the Canada, and the USA. And after they experience that, they understand it. When you get them into under 20, that's when you start to see the shoulders drop and the change in the mindset, the change in the attitude as to why am I going through this? Here I am, given the necessary commitment. We can't even get simple things from the Federation. Mm-hmm. You know, we can't even get simple things like maybe isotonic drinks from the Federation. So why am I committing myself to this? If I get injured, what is going to happen to me? Why am I going through this? And once players start to process that, because players nowadays, they mature very early. So they then look at the big picture and say, this don't have anything in it for me. They might stay on, get the scholarship, and then after that, you don't see them.
But that's what I mean. You get a scholarship, you get your education. I turned pro because I wanted to go to school. And that's the only reason, I can tell you right now, that I turned pro. They signed that contract because I wanted to go to the U.S. so I can get a scholarship, I can get to go to school to further my education because football is a short thing. So I was playing for me, for football to get me somewhere. That's my point I'm saying. Help me explain that. Neurata is good at explaining.
No. I honestly believe in tough situations like that, the environment is what controls the mindset to an extent. But what we're missing and what your thought process is on Janelle and Ms. Brown, what is missing there is that some of them don't know. I think my thing is that they don't know, they're not seeing it close enough for them to understand. Because if a player sits down and says, "Here, what? This is going to happen again because somebody told them or they've seen it for themselves," they could have the drive to say, you know what, I'll take it upon myself to just do my part. But they're not seeing, I think the players are not having access to realize what could be done. I use Akilah because it's a player under us, where I told people I have to sit down and carry this girl into schools because I want people to see that she's basically made a life of football, from football. So the car, the house, whatever she's purchased came from football. You've been playing in Europe for a certain amount of years, getting a salary from football. But a lot of people don't know that. I might think it's something that people should know, but a lot of people don't know that. And I think what happened on that day with 22,000 people is it opened the eyes. You were seeing the articles in papers, you're seeing players getting sponsorship, endorsement, all these things mm-hmm. coming about. You're mm-hmm. hearing now about who is going abroad more than you've heard before, because before, players mm-hmm. were doing it. They were getting scholarships, mm-hmm. they were playing in countries abroad, but you weren't hearing anything because it's women's football. We're hearing today if a player goes to a third division club,
correct.
Right?
Correct.
Because of that. But what happens is that in Trinidad, that when that starts to die down, or if we don't continuously mm-hmm. get the media to every day say something, the younger generation is going to grow up blindly to that. So now you're going to have under 17 girls who think nothing is going to come of it, and then they're just going to go by the wayside. But if you have these girls constantly being on papers, doing interviews, regardless of if it's bad press, good press, or whatever, they're there, you would get to realize that Trinidad thinks the male side of football locally, we think you don't get much from it. But yet still every young kid that is in secondary school thinks about playing in the Pro League, even though we think the Pro League doesn't afford them all the opportunities. Why? Because they're constantly seeing Pro League getting this, some guys in paper, somebody in the community plays in the Pro League, so they have some sort of proximity to the quote-unquote stars. In the women's side of the game, because of all the negativity that is there, we tend to distance ourselves. But once we continuously show the positive images of the women's side of the game, we don't need to care about the other aspects. It will fall into place because the demand will be there, and we will have to supply the right things, right? Because the U.S., we don't know the struggles the U.S. go through. And they do go through struggles a lot. But the reality is, we see the glamorous side of it. So that is what the media constantly pushes in the U.S., the hope. Solo doing this, this one going here, this one doing that. But yet still, for example, this player retired recently.
Abby.
What's her name?
Abby?
Yeah, Wambach. Last year, I got a call from Wambach's club to get one of the players locally there because she decided she doesn't want it anymore, even though she's getting a top salary and playing at the highest level. But did that come out in the media to say Wambach disappeared because of the stress? No. She played, she retired glamorously. And we see that image of it. So the young kid in the States right now is saying, I want to be like Wambach. Are we pushing them to say the same thing for this crop of players? Because this has been the crop of players that push the most.
That's my point. My point is they had to want to do it for them. And I hear you, and I hear you guys. Don't let the administration, my point is, don't let the administration stop you from giving it, be the best person you can be.
I don't think that's what happens.
Any girl, young girl, that gets into football, soccer, they have that woman's national team in their mind. Right. It's almost like if it's a cult.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
We don't have a cult because of the poor support that we've gotten.
Yeah.
So what are we getting into?
Right.
Yeah.
You said it there.
Yeah.
That's your favorite team. Why? Yeah. Because there's an attitude when you watch them girls.
Yeah.
You want to wear a uniform. You and mine wearing a woman's team uniform. Because it's an attitude. It's something that has been enshrined. It's a culture. There is no culture because it starts from the top. And if the top not giving you that,
exactly,
then what are we to do?
That's a
players
system.
Want it for themselves, but they also want that. They want that golden prize as well.
Maybe they get a scholarship out of it.
Yeah, but
and that's fine.
Yeah, but that's
but
not
every
all.
Player wants to get to get to the World Cup.
That's not all.
They want to have that feeling, especially when it's so close.
Yep.
And I'll use one more thing just to interject. When I did SATs, there was a question that said, "You can try and try again, but is there a point that you stop trying?" That was supposed to be the big thing. Because, yes, the mantra says try and try again. But if you try and 10 years, every tournament, the same thing happens.
Yep.
When do you stop, or do you continue for another 10 or 20 years? And I think that is the situation with these girls. They don't give up the first time. They don't give up the second time. Third, they don't give up. But I think there comes a point where...
All right. I've got a minute for each of you guys to say what you need to say about women's football, good, bad, or indifferent. I'll start with you, Jenna.
I just think that this is the beginning for women's football. I hope that the new administration can see it and give women's football on the whole the necessary support. We have the right people in the right places to move and make things happen, and the necessary successes will happen from that.
Okay.
That's it.
Yeah. All right, good.
I think Janelle said everything, you know? But in all honesty, besides just the women's, just the players scenario, I think a bigger picture in terms of women in administration for women's football, coaching, refereeing, I think that aspect also has to take some precedent when it comes to the women's game in totality as well.
For me, it would be that I think for 2015, the women's team was probably the biggest, or to the end of 2014-15, mm-hmm. would have been the biggest sporting moment for the country. And we have to realize that we can't let that moment die out. I think we have the right people, as Janelle said. I think the public is more respondent to the women's side of the game than the male for everything that is happening right now. So we really need to and for me, as an agent, it's actually easier getting the women out now because so many countries are now starting their leagues and putting a little money into football that it's actually the start of it. So we need to get our players out there and have them on a constant program.
I think women, our women's team would be the best team we have in this country, like the U.S. Women's team is the best team in the U.S. I do honestly believe that to my heart. I think there is a change in attitude, and is, like you guys say, and a change in wanting this game. And I think the women have more grit than the men. Honestly, I really feel that, and soon that's going to happen. So with you guys' support, I think you guys would make it happen because I can see and feel your passion for that woman's game and keep plugging on. To our viewers, thank you for allowing us into your homes and bringing the show to you again. We hope you enjoyed it. To Axe Television Network, thank you so much for giving us the opportunity. Isla, thank you so much.
It's a pleasure.
For being here. Janelle, I thank you as well for being here. I hope you guys will come back another time when invited, right?
Yep.
Yes.
Glad to have you. And Narada, thank you for being here, buddy.
It was a pleasure.
All right. We do have an email address, fieldofdreamstt@gmail.com. We also have a Facebook page. Drop us a line. The show has ended. Go in peace. I'll see you next Monday night at 8 p.m. Good night.